Joining me today for the Ethiopian film Difret are director Zeresnay Behare and attorney Maeza Ashenafi. I am eager to learn more about the making of this film and excited to share it with the audience. But before we get started talking about the film, Director Behare, can you please share some of your experiences at USC and even provide some advice as I plan to enroll next semester for their graduate program in journalism?
I had a lot of fun at USC. Very committed to media. The film school is fantastic, still number one. I think the resources are there, and I would say use the most of your faculty members. They're great faculty members that are there, and they've always have themselves available for us. I practically lived at the school. I came to class at 7 in the morning and usually went home about midnight. So hang out with the instructors, help out in any project that other kids were doing. And that's also very key, actually, working on other projects, not just necessarily your own. They'll give you a chance to learn the craft. With film, I played part in pretty much anything. I was a gaffer, I was a grip, and I was a first AD, I was a production assistant. So each time that you spend working on your craft, it just makes you a better professional later on in life.
Thank you, Director Behare, for sharing some of your USC experiences, as well as providing me with some advice for my future experiences at USC. Now let's get into talking more about this amazing film and some of the great characters portrayed, including one of the heroes that is here today with me. Maeza, I'll start with you with this question. What is it that you hope for young women like myself in the U.S. to gain from watching this film and learning about your advocacy work for women's rights?
The challenges related to gender equality is very much present in the United States, as much as it is in Africa. But the issues could be different, and the dynamics is different in these two worlds. Having said that, as a young woman, I think young women living in Europe or America should never take things for guaranteed. And whatever rights that you have today came because of the struggle, the sacrifice that the generation before you made. And you have to realize that, and you have to protect whatever privilege and rights that you have today, and you also have to look out for others who are less privileged.
My next question is about whether or not Harut's age was proven by the courts, and did this impact the ruling? In the film, the DA did not believe Harut was 14 because they did not believe a 14-year-old could carry a gun and run at the same time.
I think it's more of a question to Maeza than to. But I mean, my research showed me that yes, they did finally, and it wasn't because they, basically ratified that it was the correct age for her, like they said scientifically. But with the push from outside, and also the fact that in most places in Ethiopia there is no birth certificate, so the church's records are as close as they come to basically pinpointing somebody's age. I myself, my grandparents don't know how old they are because we don't keep records, especially in the villages, because they're born at home, they're not born in hospital, and I don't think we do census collection of data back in those days. So they finally have to accept and then go in that way. But still she is, the court proceedings went on as an adult, not necessarily as a minor, right?
It continued at regular courts.
Yeah.
It mm-hmm. was not a juvenile.
Yes.
But as you say, finally mm-hmm. they have accepted the certification from the church.
Right.
In the film credits, Angelina Jolie is listed as one of the executive producers. Now, she is well known for her many acting roles. So, Director Mahari, can you please describe some of her key functions in the role of producer?
Angelina came on towards the end of getting the film out. We have a lock picture, and we're couple of months out before we went to festival, so the film was already done. And the reason she actually was interested in becoming part of the film is because she saw the film, and she was really moved by it. She loved the performances of the actors, she loved the story, and she knows Ethiopia very well, and you know, her daughter is from there, and she has a very special place for Ethiopia, and she saw that we tried to tell a very difficult story, but focused on the authenticity of everything that was presented. So, I mean, it was as simple as her saying, "Hey, I want to be part of this film and I want to help, and what do you want me to do?" And we asked if we can use her name and for her to be an executive producer. So. Her input was in terms of what we should do to get the film out to the world, and she's been very instrumental in that case, doing the press, putting the film where you know, this kind of issues are discussed. So we're very grateful for that.
To follow up to that. Mm-hmm. What are you and the other producers, as well as Angelina, mm-hmm. going to do with respect to the Academy Award process?
What could we do? We just hope that we get, you know, one of the five spots for a nomination. I think what we've all realized in making the film is that, one, I mean, the focus is it's a form of art, and I... You know, Maeza and I joke about this, and how during the process I was converted into an advocate.
Yeah.
Started as a filmmaker and then became an advocate later on. But still, my entry point...
The dance goes perfectly.
My entry point always has been, how could I tell this magnificent story? And knowing what I know as a filmmaker, I used tools to be able to talk about it, a very difficult subject. And also being a man from Ethiopia and from that community, from that culture, I felt also was obligated that it is time for us to tell our own stories. You know, we can't wait for, you know, CNN or BBC to come in and do a documentary about Ethiopia. You know, we have stories that we could tell ourselves. And so I wish people see the film and realize that it is, you know, merited in its technical ability as a film, also as a story that is kind of very moving and informative at the same time. And also, I think, apart from that, I think having a nomination for the Oscars would help ignite the conversation, or reignite the conversation we were having in 1996 when this case came about.
Talking about the issue, mm-hmm. Violence against women, or the whole issue of gender equality issues, mm-hmm. But they don't really understand what women go through. So if they have the opportunity to watch a movie like this, they will understand, and they will be able to connect.
Right, and I would add to that, you know, our producer, Merit Mandafro, always have said about the story, how, you know, until now, or until we started, you know, to do this project,
yeah.
we've always known abduction as stats, you know, number,
exactly.
you know, the cell,
yeah.
this, mm-hmm. it didn't have a face.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what this film did is that it gave you a face, a person. You've seen, you saw a young girl mm-hmm. who was really affected by this tradition that, you know, went on for years and years,
yeah.
centuries.
Yeah.
So, for the first time now, people have sort of an in point into understanding what abduction is and what it does to our young women.
Maeza, the film portrays your character as having a mentor. He has a small role, but a significant influence. Many great leaders like yourself share they have mentors or role models and the importance of having one. Can you tell us if his role was real in your life and describe your relationship?
I was very lucky have had this opportunity to work with a senior person,
mm-hmm.
The person you're talking. He was actually the Ethiopia's foreign minister during the emperor's time,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he's an influential person. Then he was on exile for 17 years. He used to live here
mm-hmm.
in the United States.
Yeah.
Then he came back to Ethiopia in 1992, and he was chair of the Ethiopian Constitution Commission when we were drafting the new constitution for the country.
Mm-hmm.
So I was a staff member at the Constitution Commission, but I worked very closely with him because I was assigned to the human rights panel of the commission.
Mm-hmm.
And that was an opportunity for me to get exposure to human rights issues, and that's the entire issue of public service and, you know, commitment to a cause and so on. So I said I am lucky in that regard, because many of my generations, or the generations that came after me, they don't have this kind of opportunity working with senior people. Finding mentors and so on. So his influence has been beyond, you know, advising me on this particular case, because this film is not necessarily about Hirut's case. It is about the work of the organization.
Mm-hmm.
So he has been a guiding light for
mm-hmm.
me,
mm-hmm.
you know, beginning from establishing the organization and running the organization, as well as you know, strategizing when we have challenges and problems, like
mm-hmm.
when the organization was suspended. So he has been there through and through.
What made you want to start an organization versus
yeah.
a law firm, or
yeah.
perhaps practicing in a law firm?
Yeah. It was 1993 where myself and another colleague were sent to the Netherlands Hague
mm-hmm.
for a training, a human rights training.
Mm-hmm.
And there we met several African women lawyers who also came for same training. And they told us about their experience, how they're organizing and fighting for the rights of women, that they have established women lawyers associations in their respective countries, Kenya, Uganda, and so on. So we felt that we were left out because we were coming out from a military government. There was no freedom of association, no freedom of speech, and we were sort of in the dark. So we say, wow, this is a very exciting idea. So we ran with the idea. We went back and we established the association.
Great.
Yeah, that's how it started.
Director Mahari, can you please explain what was it like meeting Maeza and why you felt inspired to share her story and her organization in a film?
It was 2005, I think. I was in Ethiopia working on a documentary project, and I met her brother Fukru through a friend. And then when he found out that I was a filmmaker, he said, oh, you should make a film about my sister.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, yeah, right, why not, you know? And I didn't really take it very seriously because I get that a lot from people. It's like, well, you should make a story about me, you know, it's like,
yeah.
Or like how I survived, you know, this, you know, whatever. So anyway,
my friends are making that request. Particularly, there is this woman who went through divorce. She said, if he doesn't make a movie out of my story.
Which is such a, you know, such a great, I mean, we all want to, you know, it's like, especially Ethiopians, I mean, storytelling is part of our culture, and we revere storytellers, so we love, I mean, I, you know, we have oral history, and I love growing up, and, you know, both my grandparents were at home, and they would tell us stories, you know. I did not go to the village, you know, where they grew up, but I knew everything about it because of the stories that they told. So, you know, with Maeza, I didn't take it very seriously, but her name kind of stayed with me. So I was just out of school, not just, but a couple of years, and working in LA. So when I came back, and then one day I just, you know, why don't I just look up for her? And I typed in, and about a million things came up. And then I said, holy moly. And started reading, and then it was, one, it's so refreshing to find, you know, to see a young person doing something extraordinary, you know. So within 4 months, I had compiled a book this big, and went back to Ethiopia and asked to meet her. And she was skeptical at first when I told her that I wanted to make a film about her life and her organization and the work that she's done, and rightfully so, I think, you know, that we don't have that many men in Ethiopia kind of wanted to do a story about women, even though I didn't see it as such, you know. For me as a filmmaker, it was just an amazing story of somebody passionate about the work that they were doing, and they were making a difference. They changed a law in the country, you know. So I think after a couple of meetings, she saw I was sincere, and I wasn't gonna stop asking her.
Yeah, I think it was the same day, because I remember you came with your file,
yeah.
And we were living in an apartment,
yeah.
And you sat on the floor.
Yeah,
I still
know.
Remember, you were so excited.
Yeah.
I said, this guy is passionate,
yeah.
The issue, and I will give him any support that
yeah.
you need, so...
Yeah. And I needed
yeah.
that.
Maeza, how do you feel about Mayron's performance of portraying your character?
I get that question a lot. And my answer is always the same. She's great. Mayron is great, and she sort of accomplished her task very successfully, I would say. I am goal focused, but at the same time I'm very compassionate. I empathize with people, and Mayron manifested all that, and she did it with seamlessly.
In the movie, it showed that because you were straightforward,
mm.
or because you were focused, career-oriented,
mm.
that it may have, what some consider, hindered you being married or hindered your personal life.
I am married.
And in the movie.
In the movie.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was my next question.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that true, or was that for the movie? And how do you feel about that work-life balance when people
yeah.
say that
yeah.
if women are career-oriented, they can't have that family
yeah.
life?
Yeah, yeah, it is true. In that context,
mm-hmm.
I was not married.
Uh-huh.
I was single.
Uh-huh.
I was a machine.
Uh-huh.
You
yeah.
used that.
Yeah.
I
yeah.
go to the office
yeah.
8 in the morning, and I leave 9.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, that was my life.
Mm-hmm.
And Z showed a little bit of flirtation here and there, and that much yes existed. But in terms of focus, yes, I lived, you know, my work. I sleep with it. I wake up with it, and that was my life. And I think that's what, it's not only me.
But I don't think it stopped from people having interest in you. It didn't stop that. And I think in the film, what I was trying to do with it is that, yes, I see it. I mean, my wife is like that. I mean, she's, you know, if I don't tell, you know, it's like, okay, I'm going to bed, and it's past midnight, and she's still working. And she was doing that before we got married, too. So,
yeah.
And but one is not, it doesn't have to happen on the absence of the other,
yes,
you know.
Yes,
and
it's not mutually exclusive.
Exactly, yeah.
Especially if your partner or husband is supportive. Like,
yeah.
I'm so lucky because my husband is a professor,
yeah.
And he's an educator.
Yeah.
He believed in my work, and he continued to push me even after I was married. So
yeah.
I just continued to accomplish even today.
Thank you, Maeza. Referring back to the film's controversial subject matter, the custom law called Talifa in the Amharic language, Director Z, did you discover the practice of the tradition to be widespread?
No, it's not. So that was one of the things that I actually found in the research that kind of surprised me. Here we are, you know, 90 million people in Ethiopia, and different religions and different ethnic groups, and we do it, you know, from end to end, you know, in the north, in the south, you know, it all happens. And so when I found out that it had no religious space, or it didn't have any, it wasn't exclusive to a certain group, you can't really pinpoint like why it still happens or how did it even begin. And then farther, like, we went and then we were doing the research, and then we found out that Ethiopia is not even in top five of you know, this tradition of in the abundance of this tradition. So India, Pakistan, Malaysia, and then so it is something that is practiced globally as well. So, but the way it happened in Ethiopia was unique, and it was interfering with the constitutional law because people were afraid talking about it or addressing such a problem because it had the disguise of a tradition. So the law enforcement did not go there because they feared that it would start social upheaval, you know, because this was something that was practiced for centuries again, you know. So one of the things that I was trying to make, and this was the problem when I first talked to Maeza, I remember, like, one of the questions I asked is, what is the problem, you think? And then she said, enforcement. You know, the law existed since 1957, but it seemed like there is a different set of rules in the city, and then there's a different set of rules in the countryside.
Thank you, Director Z. Maeza, what do you hope or expect from the audience reaction after watching the film Difret?
If it inspires action, it's fantastic. If it inspires conversation, that is absolutely fantastic. And I am sure it will be a tool for a change, not only in Ethiopia, but I believe also even globally.
Mm-hmm.
3 months ago, I was in Oslo, and I was invited to address students between the age of 15 and 16, about 200 students,
mm-hmm.
in high school. So the kids were made to watch the movie,
mm-hmm.
and we had a discussion about the movie, and they raised up their hands and they said, what can we do?
Mm-hmm.
How can we help?
Mm-hmm.
So these are kids who never heard about Africa.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They don't know what's happening.
Yeah.
But they say, what can we do? So that was a moment for me,
yeah.
to realize that this film will accomplish something.
Are there other traditions? Are there other aspects of customs that are similar to Talifa that are going on in Ethiopia that need to be changed or revised or eliminated? Do you know of any other type?
Oh, we have many. I think FGM is early marriage is another one. And, you know, there's a lot of work has been done on this. But again, I think you take one down and then the next one would be easier to tackle because people know that it's connected. There are, again, I keep talking about, you know, the first step is understanding that these things are violence. This are criminal acts that we're doing to our young women on the auspices of tradition. So how do you change the tradition? You know, we have this thing that we say, we're trying to build a culture of courage because Difret means courage. So how do we do that is by educating, by practicing it. You know, we almost have to come up with a new culture, I guess, you know. Someone asked me, like, do you think this thing's gonna be eliminated, you know, soon? And my answer to that is, you know, I don't think we can change the tradition if we don't start young. We have to basically educate our young kids, boys especially, you know, from young age, age of 3, 4, you know, we have to teach them about gender equality. We have to teach them about creating a culture of courage, speaking out, or not practicing something because if your dad did it, or your relatives did it, or your neighbors did it. Mm-hmm. So if we'd be able to focus on those things, then yes, there are many traditions that we can get rid of. And don't get me wrong, we have beautiful, beautiful traditions in Ethiopia, and we're very proud of them. But certain traditions, I don't think we should live with.
I agree with everything that you said, and the good news is that we have laws that criminalize such behaviors, including human genital mutilation, abduction, so on and so on. To some extent, that is the easier part. You can have policies, you can have laws, but you know, using those laws and making a real change in the community is part of the bigger challenge. These practices are entrenched. They have been there for years. And sometimes women are the custodians of this culture. Mm-hmm. It's because they are socialized. And if they don't do that, they will not get community acceptance. They will not be accepted by the decision makers, by the opinion leaders. Their girls will not be married if they are not circumcised. Mm-hmm. So it is, this change, it requires the involvement of all the actors. So we need laws, but we need law enforcement, and we also need education. Public education is, I think, a key component in all this process.
I'm going to talk now, though. Wizero, Maeza, you brought some clarity to the point because some of us here in the West, we wonder why the women actually do the circumcision or do the
female genital mutilation, yes.
Exactly, yes. And they do it to their own daughters or their own family. So you brought a good point with respect to they want to feel included in society and don't want to be. So that gives us a better understanding.
Yeah.
The final question, some of us have traveled to Ethiopia and we've seen, you know, women in certain roles, they're leading NGOs, they're leading organizations, and it seems like from the outside that women, you know, they aren't doing as great as maybe women in other places, but they seem like they're doing well. Is that kind of the case, or is it just on the surface?
Well, things are changing.
Yeah.
Because I can give you my own personal example. My mom, she was never sent to school. She's a very bright, strong woman, but she did not get the chance to go to school because her generation, women of her generation, were never allowed to go to school. But here I am, and okay, I was the only one in my low class of 50.
The only woman, the only girl.
The only girl.
Yeah.
Just in the span of 20 or 30 years, things are happening because I'm trained as a lawyer, along with my colleagues. We are claiming the space and the political space at that. And we are demanding legislative reform, and we're working for gender equality. Before my generation, if a woman is a nurse or a successful teacher, that is a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Now things are changing. So the next generation who are coming after me will do even better, because now about 25% of the law students are girls.
Mm-hmm.
And change is happening, but surely it takes time. I agree with you, there are leaders in the business sector, there are leaders in the NGO sector, and even in the government to some extent. But we want to see more, because every Sunday when I open the newspaper, I always see the faces of men, as if like women don't exist in that country. So I want to see also the women's face on the newspapers, making political decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Me too.
Great.
Thank you, Director Zeresnay and Attorney Maeza, for your time and answering the questions. Now welcome Tizita Hager. For your first film, you deliver an amazing performance, playing one of the lead roles as the character Hirut. Can you please describe what were some of the challenges you faced during the making of this film?
For me, it was difficult to get up so early and getting on so late, like at 9:30, something like that. And running was so hard, because Hirut runs in the farm, and by having that big gun, so that was really hard.
Thank you, Tizita. How do you compare growing up in the city, Addis Ababa, versus growing up in the rural areas?
We have more opportunity than the rural area, and we get well education, and and we're equal. Like we know what our rights are, but there just no rights at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
But is there something you would like to say to the young girls here in America?
I think they have a really good life here, so I want them to think about the others out there, because so many girls are suffering for this abduction and other things. So I want them to think about that and do something on it.
Thank you. Can you explain your approach for playing the role of Hirut? You mentioned one of the ways you got into character was by deliberately not combing your hair. Why did you feel you had to take such an approach?
I don't know. I thought it was because I was tired, but when I realized it, I wasn't her. Like, it was not me. I put muds in my leg for the makeup. Then I just got home, was changing my clothes, just in sleep, like no washing, no anything. I was just her. I think I wanted to be real hero. Yeah.
Well, any of what you learned in the community workshop that Z, the director, found you, was any of that able to be used in your performance, would you say?
Yeah, but I spent there only 1 month. So, yeah, but it helps a lot.
You're a freshman in school. What is it that you like to study in school?
Usually in Ethiopia we study like 11 subjects. We don't choose till 12. So I'm learning all of them.
Can you give us an example or what kind of subjects you take?
We take Amhari, English, and others, biology, physics, the science things. And we get into a great thing. We're gonna choose whether we went the art thing or natural, like we call them natural science and social science. Then we're gonna get our own interest after that.
Thank you, Tizata. Do you have any friends or relatives that live in the rural area? And how often, if so, do you come in contact or speak with them?
Yeah, I have a sister from there. Like, I have a big family, and there, I have a sister. She came from a rural area. No, ours is so modern, like, ours is great. But there, they don't even know what TV is. And like men do everything. They decide on everything. I think they're the rule of that land. They're being so tough.
Yeah, that sounds like America. Well, that brings me to my last question then. And there is one scene in the movie where you come into Maeza's apartment. And your expression and your performance was like surprising of all the electronic and modern day things. Where did you get that idea to be like that, or what made you walk in the room and show that expression?
Well, just like I said, I have so many sisters and brothers from the rural area, and we show them everything. So like I can see their feeling, their face. So I think I get that from there and from movies.
That's great. All right, well, thank you so much for your time. And again, great job on your film, being your first film at that. And I wish you well with the Academy Awards.
Thank you so much.
Morning to you, man. Morning to your love. I say, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today?
The black oasis, ancient Africa, the sacred awaken, the sleeping giant. Science, art is your creation. I dreamt that we could visit old Kemet. Your history is too complex and rigid for some Western critics. They want the whole subject diminished. But Africa's the origin of all the world's religions. We praise bridges that carried us over the battlefronts of Sudanic soldiers, the task put before us.
You hear me out? Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today?
Who are we today? The slums, diseases, AIDS, we need that all to fade. We cannot be afraid. So who are we today? We are the morning after, the makeshift youth, the slave ship captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter. The ancestral lineage built pyramids. America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from now waters. The first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray? Each in his own way, teaching and learning, we can work it out. We'll have a warm bed, we'll
We'll have some warm bread and shelter from the storm dread, and we can work it out. Mother Nature feeds all in famine and drought. Tell those selfish in ways not to share us out. What's a tree without root? Lion without tooth? Lie without truth, you hear me out. Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings. Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, Lord. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may some more love come. Yesterday we were kings. I tell you, young blood, this world is yours today.
Yo, daddy, why never the tire? O ninki torte dinche, wadin ke tire? O tam markila tiso, wadin ke tunche? O ta ad ninki tam ay, wadin ke tohe? Yo, daddy, why never the tire? O ninki torte dinche, wadin ke tire? O tam markila tiso, wadin ke tunche? O ta ad ninki tam ay, wadin ke tohe? Yesterday we were kings. Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?